Well, good evening, and welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations and the screening room here, also known as the Peterson Room. So what you're going to do is have here is for 85 minutes, we're going to show the documentary made by Vice, A World in Disarray. And as you will see, it's a combination of extraordinary on-the-scene journalism by various Vice news teams and journalists. And then it's interspersed with reflections of any number of people you will recognize, one of whom is Ash Carter, former Secretary of Defense. And then afterwards, we're going to have a conversation led by Juju Chang of Nightline about issues raised by the film or not raised to the film, and then we'll obviously have that with you, with our members and our guests. Film came about because of the inspiration of Richard Plepler. I had the really rare good idea of giving Richard a copy of The Galley. Richard got excited by The Galley, and the next thing we knew, we were off to the races, and this is the result. You're great to come out tonight. We very much hope you find it interesting, you like it. It's not the most uplifting film you've ever seen, let me warn you. So take your Xanax or whatever else you need to get through it, but your reward afterwards is to hear the former Secretary of Defense. So thanks again, and we'll restart the conversation in about 85 minutes.
So gratified to be here tonight and to be part of this screening as a broadcast journalist for 30 years. I'm Juju Chang of ABC News Nightline, and it's rare to be able to see a piece like this that fuses sort of ivory tower wisdom with that kind of heart-stopping on-the-ground conflict zone reporting and have it have context and meaning. And so hats off to Vice and HBO and... I'm here as your presider tonight, and as you can see to my left is joining me, Richard Haass, the inspiration and the author for the film, as well as, of course, the president of this august body, yes. And he also, as you know, worked in both Bush administrations, and to his right is his good friend. There's a bit of a bromance going on this evening. Ash Carter, who, in the spirit of bipartisanship, worked in the Obama administration, as you know, as defense secretary, is now director of the Belfer Center at the Kennedy School. Team red, team
Mr.
blue.
Mr. Belfer sitting in the second row.
Oh, how lovely.
And Mrs. Belfer.
Mrs. Belfer, lovely. And as Stephanie Carter said as we walked in this evening, it's nice to see Richard in person instead of just on the TV. But welcome to you both, Richard.
Thank you, Juju. It's always nice to be welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations. We're going to start, and Juju's going to ask questions. But I just want to—I want to embarrass my friend here, and I want to thank Ash for four things. One, we've been friends for over 30 years now. We used to teach together at the Kennedy School. Two, I want to thank him for being in the film. Three, I want to thank him and Stephanie for making the trek here tonight, all the way from Boston. And fourth and most important, I really want to thank him for his public service. When they make the short list of great secretaries of defense and public service, this gentleman will be on it.
I told you it's a bromance. But mutual. Also, as you know, they both spent a little time at Oxford University, both as Rhodes Scholars. But Ash Carter, I think, has you beat because he taught physics while he was there as well.
The only reason, yeah.
Exactly. But as you can see, we have quite a bit of intellectual firepower for this evening's abbreviated discussion. So let's begin, if we look at the film as, you know, four examples of four corners of a world in disarray, we really want to be prescriptive, looking forward about how to deal with those hot spots. Let's start with North Korea, yep. Where Condoleezza Rice says it's the issue that keeps her up at night. You wrote in the recent Foreign Affairs that this is the issue that Donald Trump rightly has identified as the single biggest threat to our national security. How do we move forward in North Korea?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked because that was unrelieved gloom. And so you need to say to yourself, well, what do we do now? Because this is serious business. So starting with North Korea, two things. The first is, and you saw that, we are ready and have to be ready. The slogan of U.S. Forces Korea is fight tonight, which is, as I indicated in what I said, not something you want to do because it's a war which we would win, but the intensity of violence in which would be of a magnitude the world hasn't seen since the last Korean War, so it's serious business. However, we have to be ready to deter, and we are, that's something we constantly improve, and to defend, which is where missile defenses come in. We try to stay one step ahead of the North Koreans all the time. So for example, in respect of the possibility that they will complete the development of an ICBM that could carry a nuclear weapon, we started a number of years ago to build missile defenses, which defend us against that. That said, none of this is completely reassuring because I dealt with all three generations of the Kims, and they get worse in every successive generation. And so you can't count on deterrence and rational things in that case. That gets to the other part, and I'll be quick here. Everyone tends to say, and you read one thing after another, there's diplomacy and there's war, and diplomacy doesn't look very plausible and war doesn't look very palatable. So what do we do? I have a different view, which is these are two things that go together. And so a coercive diplomatic strategy is one in which you carry out talks with the North Koreans along with China, which hasn't done much at all with respect to North Korea. I don't hold out great hopes, but it's worth a try. And Japan and South Korea. And you're preparing the way for two roads, one of which leads down to a diplomatic settlement, and we can talk about what the terms of that would be. And the other one leads to coercion, but in which case you have prepared better the way for that. You've prepared yourself militarily, you have brought the South Koreans and the Japanese on board, and you've sidelined the Chinese. If it comes to that, those are conditions that are important. It's not an ideal place to be, but that creates the conditions for it. So these two things go together, and it's not an either-or thing. It's the two things going together. I believe that's the path to take.
Richard, you're just back from South Korea. Is this a bilateral move? Is this a multilateral move? And where does China come in on all this?
Well, it's got to be multilateral because even though we have commitments and we have 28,500 troops on the 38th parallel or close to it, it's South Korean real estate first and foremost. The entire Seoul is, there's three rules in real estate: location, location, location. In the case of the Korean Peninsula, there's also the same rules when it comes to strategy, and Seoul is awfully close to the 38th parallel. It's in range of North Korean artillery. Japan is in the neighborhood, it's in range of North Korean missiles. So we don't have unilateral options, so we've got to concert with them. And that's not easy. If you look at the initiative of the new South Korean president over the last couple of days, it has elements of the old sunshine policy. And there's always been a little bit of tension between Washington and Seoul on how to prioritize various aspects of the North Korean threat. And I think the potential for that to come to the fore is real. So there's a real emphasis on some diplomatic deftness here, not to be confused with deafness. So I think there's that. Ash is exactly right on China. China has a lot more influence than they let on. The problem is, I think their strategic preference is for some version of the status quo. They're not wild about North Korean missiles. They think the North Koreans are nuts. But they, that old saw about France in the old days, they like Germany so much, they're glad there were two of them. Well, the French view of Germany during the Cold War is the Chinese view of the Korean Peninsula now. So I think we should take a run at arms control, at some kind of a negotiated outcome, for two reasons. One, it may work. It won't solve the problem, but it could put a ceiling on it. If not, it's a little bit like the Gulf War. We tried sanctions after Saddam invaded Kuwait, not because we were wildly optimistic they would work, But sometimes it's important to show you tried certain remedies before you turn to other remedies. It's part of your management of domestic and international politics. And I think we need to do that in Korea, only because whether we do use military force or we are prepared to live with some combination of deterrence and a more robust missile and more general defense, those are big choices with real consequences either way. And I just feel we owe it to ourselves and our allies and everyone else to take a run at the negotiated outcome. And it's not sequential, by the way, and that's where Ash's point, I think, is exactly right. This has all got to be simultaneous. We've got to prepare certain contingencies, create a context. I think it increases the odds that arms control might work. It might get the Chinese attention. But if not, then we're prepared to have an alternative.
And just to broaden that to the South China Sea, which is just another point of conflict in that region, how does the Trump administration, you know, engage China in that way? Looking at both issues.
Okay. Well, engage isn't the word that comes to mind immediately to me. I mean, you do have to stand strong. This 9-dash line, does anybody remember the little story about Harold and the purple crayon when you were a little kid? And he'd draw something with a crayon and it would be so. The 9-dash line is like that. It's nonsense. And that this Chinese scholar, or whoever he was, stands there with a straight face and says all that stuff is nonsense. And you need to stand strong against nonsense. And unfortunately, you know, they use the Philippines as an example, which under its current leadership is a little shaky as a bulwark against China. But for us, this is, and Richard said this very wisely, it is the most consequential region of the world for America's future. It's half of the population of the world, half of the economic activity of the world. So if you compare it to Middle East and so forth, in terms of fundamental consequence to American purpose and prosperity and everything else, it is a fundamental region. It's a place where we've played a winning hand for 70 years now. In a region where they all hate each other and have deep, deep wounds of the past, and we have seen better than everybody else under those circumstances, and we have led a principled order which China has benefited from. That's the road to stick to, in my judgment. And most of the countries in the region, they look at China the way I look at China, which is, there's a battle going on in these two sides of the Chinese mind between those who understand that on the whole that's done them pretty good, that's been a pretty good deal for them, and the other one, which is this overweening sense that history is now on their side and they have to, and that's what you saw in some of those fishermen. I think Richard's comments in the movie reflected the same thing. You have to do what you need to do, which is to check that more malignant purpose and to encourage the other. Now, we're not alone in that, because almost everybody else in the region sees things the same way. So we have a lot going for us militarily and in terms of friends and allies in the region. That's a strong hand to play, but it needs to be played.
What we need to do is take three things. One is the diplomatic involvement and concert with our allies, because a big part of Asian stability has been the alliance system. Secondly, and it's, I think, one of the real mistakes of the current administration, which is the TPP, and you know, Ash once said he'd trade a carrier battle group for it. It would have been a good deal for us. But we've taken away, in many ways, the economic underpinning of our position in that part of the world. And then militarily, we've got to do regular challenges to Chinese claims. We can't let them stand. And it was something that was carried out with a greater frequency under the previous administration than this one. And I would just simply say we need to make a habit of making clear that Chinese claims and Chinese activities, whether it's building islands where none existed, that doesn't change the reality of the openness of these seas and the openness of these skies. And we've got to be prepared to demonstrate that with sufficient regularity.
You talk in the book about creative multilateralism moving forward, and you mentioned TPP, and so some of the things we talked about are in the film or some are not. I'm curious how you think about multilateralism moving forward in the Trump administration. You look at the Paris Climate Accords, TPT is your example, but there's also the reaffirmation of NATO How do you see it moving forward?
Look, to me, multilateralism is simply, it's necessary. There's very few things we can do better unilaterally than we can do with others. In some ways, multilateralism is the diplomatic reflection of the reality of globalization. There's just certain things we don't have our own answers to. We need collective responses. There's limits to our resources, as we've seen. Now, multilateralism can take many forms. You know, I'm a great believer in being creative about it. It could be forum shopping. If you remember when the Russians made it impossible to go through the UN at the time of the Balkan Wars, we took it to NATO. So other times we've created ad hoc approaches. So multilateralism should never be confused with UNism. That's simply a form. It's the most formal form. But I think it's a diplomatic reality that you've got to forge various types of coalition, be it of the willing, or I prefer standing arrangements when we can have them, because standing arrangements give you more heft. They have greater deterrent value. They're not simply responsive. But I would have said in the old days, that's why we have a State Department. But how quaint. Anyhow.
Can I just say?
Go ahead.
I just want to associate myself with Richard in that regard. And just say, you know, people tend to think about American leadership as a gift we give to foreigners. It's not. It's one of the ways we get what we want. And well, that's the way you think need to think. It's not a favor to anybody. It's for us.
And that's where, by the way, America First, I think, is an unfortunate phrasing. I think we're stuck with it, because the president's committed so much. We're stuck with it for now. But I do think it, both in symbolism and in many cases in practice, it's inconsistent with the kind of leadership where you get what you want, because I think it becomes a bit self-isolating rather than the sort of leadership that forges collective response.
You're talking about America getting what it wants. You speak in the film very eloquently about knowing what Putin wants and how sort of direct he is about it. Given that, you know, Russia, especially vis-a-vis Syria, has become, you know, strategically important to the mission there, how do we move forward in this climate where there's so much scrutiny on our partnerships and our relationship with Russia?
Well, you always try to work with people, with other countries, malodorous as they may be in many ways, wherever you can find, you can align your interests. And that's true with Russia, it's true with China, and so forth. The reality is that where we and Russia have been able to align our interests in recent years, in particular under Vladimir Putin, that scope for that has narrowed. There are some areas, they're not completely unhelpful in North Korea. They were helpful in Iran in some ways, but when it comes to Ukraine, hacking our election, Syria, where they said they were going to go in and fight terrorism and move and promote a political transition from Assad, they did neither. Careless brandishing of nuclear weapons, violating the INF treaty. I mean, it goes on and on and on and on. And as I said in there, people ask me sometimes, do you think you know what Vladimir Putin is thinking? And I said, well, the man says exactly what's on his mind. You don't have to wonder. Now, I can't agree with that, but it's not like he's mysterious. He's entirely out there about it, but he has defined in an important respect success for Russia as thwarting the United States. It's very hard to work with that motivation. If they want to work on North Korea, but they have a different view of it, that you can get around. But if their idea of success is screwing you, that's a little hard to build a bridge to.
Did you learn that when you studied physics?
And that's where it gets hard. Now, you know, I'm all for working with people where you can, and you keep trying, and people say, well, shouldn't we be talking to one side or another, North Korea, anything? But yeah, but it's a matter of what you say. It's not what you talk to somebody, it's what you say.
Richard, how does the concept of sovereign obligations, the idea of finding common goals, play out with our relationship with Vladimir Putin?
It's not obvious for the most part. I mean, the idea of sovereign obligation, which is developed in the book, not in the film, it was hard to put it into film, is the idea that we need an international border that's based more than on rights. And states, we need those. We need to have rights. The idea that you can't be invaded, borders should not be changed coercively. My argument is simply that in a world in which nothing stays local for long and what happens virtually anywhere, that now countries need to accept rights, I mean obligations along with their rights of sovereignty. And whether it's terrorists, as we saw in Afghanistan at 9/11, or climate issues, or you can't have hackers operate out of your territory, you have to exercise control over what takes place in your territory because it's not going to stay there and it could affect our interests. So this is not, in the old days we used to say, well, we can't interfere anywhere because it's their prerogative about how they run their society. Up to a point, fair enough. But I'm basically saying in a global era, what happens anywhere doesn't stay there. And we need to think, and that ought to become, I think, the navigational compass for American foreign policy. I think clearly Mr. Putin does not quite have that view. He has a really old-fashioned, narrow sense, and he is a spoiler. I think his outcomes are essentially things that give him and Russia greater prestige. I think that's probably his second motive. His principal motive is to maintain power, which is what he's about more than anything else. I think, you know, there's more of an open issue with countries like China. Obviously, Europe are much closer there. The thing I didn't anticipate when I wrote about it was that we would not sign up to it. And I think in some ways that's the great change in the international system in the last 6 months, is that the United States, which for the last 70 years has been the principal provider of many of the foundation stones of order, again, not as a form of philanthropy, but as a form of self-interest, because we understood that global order was really good for American security and prosperity. For the first time, really, since FDR and since Truman, we have a president who doesn't accept that tenet and see things through a more narrow calculus. And this is so the idea of advancing the kinds of things I was arguing for in the book, it'll have to be advanced, but it will come either from others, Europe, some other countries selectively, even selectively China, or in some cases, like in climate, it may come from governors and mayors.
Right.
That will see others have a foreign policy footprint. But the U.S. government as a federal actor, as an international actor, and we've seen it with TPP and Paris most dramatically, I don't think is prepared to play that kind of traditional role right now.
I just want to interject for a second, because this is where we ask the members to provide questions to our distinguished panel members. Looking forward, so feel free to just raise your hand. There'll be people with microphones who will come towards you. Obviously, looking forward in terms of cybersecurity or terror, these are all issues, or pandemics, these are all issues that, are...
Those are for the sequel, too.
Yeah, that's for the sequel.
Just those of you who want to admit more, the potential for greater disarray is
even
out there.
More disarray. That's the...
You can relax.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead.
Gentlemen, my name is Tara Hariharan. I'm from NWI Management. A question on broader U.S.-China relations, considering we have the comprehensive economic dialogue starting tomorrow, and the administration has been very particular about protectionism and reducing trade imbalances. Is that going to be the point of contention that alienates China versus the United States instead of a skirmish in the South China Sea?
I'll take a...
Is it a trade war?
Loaded term for it, but I think we need to be real about the economic relationship with China also. We have never been, as a country, in a sustained economic relationship of scale with a communist-controlled economy. With the Soviet Union, we had a very strict system of economic segregation. So we competed, but it was across a barrier of trade. And so I don't think on behalf of our companies and our people, we can pretend that playing by the same rules with China is going to succeed. They bring the instrument of the state to bear, and they make investments in technology, they advantage their companies, they support intellectual property exploitation and theft. They dominate the internet and control the internet. All these things we don't do. And I think that creates a not the plain field of normal economic affairs as it is with Europe. That's a serious fact. Now, I won't take that to trade war as a loaded, but I think that we have to be intentional on behalf of our own people and our own companies. They look at us and they say, we expect our government to stick up for us and to help us in what is a disadvantaged circumstance for many of our companies. And I think that needs to be said. Economic policy making was not my thing. Richard knows a lot more about this, but I think it's something to take seriously.
I just sort of say what makes it really complicated, though, is the issue we were talking about a few minutes ago. We've got priorities with North Korea, South China Sea, so you can't approach the economic issue in isolation. Access to Chinese markets for American firms and exports is incredibly important to our economy, and China's one of the two largest holders of American debt. So it's one of the reasons you've got to approach national security in its totality, and if we simply have a narrow pursuit and we get focused on what for the life of me I do not understand, which is trade deficits and imbalances per se, we will drive ourselves into a rather bad ditch.
Another question up here.
So I asked this reluctantly, not to add to our
Andy,
woes.
You have to introduce yourself.
Andy Alper, sorry. Thank you, Richard. I asked this reluctantly not to add to our woes, but the one horror story you didn't talk about was Pakistan and the nuclear weapons in Pakistan, the perhaps lack of control. Could you say a word or two about where Pakistan is on your scare meter?
It's very concerning to me. And we were talking before we came in about something that Richard had a great deal to do with, and it was a major achievement in history, which is the ending of the Cold War in a peaceful manner. And apropos of nuclear weapons, I then ran the Nunn-Lugar program in the early part of the 1990s. Now, there was a circumstance where the only circumstance in which a nuclear power disintegrated. Inherent in that is great risk, because we tend to think about people using nuclear weapons, the North Koreans, the Soviets during the Cold War, but there's another danger, which is the possibility of loose nukes and things in a situation of loose control or governmental collapse or terrorists kind of taking over a country, nuclear weapons falling in the hands of that. These are real issues with respect to today's Pakistan. So you're right to put it on your list. It's an entirely different kind of nuclear danger from North Korea, which is more intentional and organized. But it's very grave. And there are things that can be done about it, like we did after the end of the Cold War. And we look back now and people forget. Things turn out well, and you discount that. But if you remember what it was like to live in those years, it was quite concerning. And it all's well that ends well. But it's concerning to me, Pakistan.
Yes, in the back.
Thank you. My name is Andres Correa. I'm a South American correspondent. And my question is about Venezuela. Venezuela is in this continent. We have been talking about a crisis. We are far away. But although Venezuela is very, very close ally, the government, to North Korea, Iran, and China, and my question is, do you think the Obama administration failed to prevent the crisis in Venezuela in order to advance through Cuba? Thank you.
I wouldn't put it that way. To say that we failed would suggest that we had a lot more control or influence over the course of events than we did. I mean, I was sent at one point on a mission to talk to Mr. Chavez, and let me just say it was not the most productive 4 hours I ever spent. We are where we are. We can, I'll leave it to historians to decide what we might have done. I think the real question now is what we do. And I would think there's a strong case for putting greater economic pressure on Venezuela. And we ought to, it's a cash crop economy based upon oil. So we ought to be thinking about how we limit its ability to sell its oil. But I also think working very closely with its neighbors, we ought to think about what would be the, how do we maintain social and physical order in Venezuela? Venezuela has all the potential to become a failed state, and I think that would be a catastrophe. And this is something where, again, we used the word creative multilateralism before. You can't do it through the Organization of American States. That's unanimity. You need unanimity to act organization. Cubans and others make it impossible. But we ought to be essentially having the equivalent of a Friends of Venezuela type coalition to think about what sort of common action can be taken to avoid to avert a real catastrophe.
To stick to council rules, we're going to try to end on time, but I want to get to as many member questions as I can. So let's take three, and then we'll have a
lightning round.
A lightning round. Okay. One, two, and then three in the back. Okay.
This is like double Jeopardy.
I know. I'll take Bosnia for 500. Hey,
Byron Wien, Blackstone Group. The United States is growing at about 2%. China's growing at 5 or 6. In the 2030s, if those trajectories maintain, China will be the largest economy in the world. In May and June, I spent 4 weeks out of 5 in Asia and Europe. And the thing that was I was left with talking to policy officials there is that American leadership is eroding very seriously as a result of losing economic dominance as well as political influence. Do you agree with that? Do you agree with the fact that during the last 3 presidential administrations, our influence in the world has eroded, and that has affected our ability to negotiate a fruitful settlement in North Korea?
Okay, we're going to collect 3?
Yeah, we're going to try. Okay. Middle question hand right there. Yep. And granted, we have about 2 minutes left.
David Nachman, I would just assume for a moment that diplomacy doesn't succeed in getting the North Korean regime to eliminate its nuclear intentions. What is it about the North Korean statements lead you to conclude that we must take out their military weapons? What specifically have they done to suggest that they intend an offensive first use, as opposed to what some analysts say has been a consistent, perhaps paranoid, but nevertheless defensive stance?
Thank you. And one last in the back.
Hi, thanks so much. James Reinl with the Middle East Eye. It's an Iran question. I mean, what we've seen in the last few days with the administration recertifying the nuclear deal, but also leveling sanctions, Mr. Zarif's comments from this room last night, and these possible flashpoints in Iraq and Syria, what kind of trajectory do you think the US and Iran are on right now?
As we can see from these questions, there's a very big world in a lot of disarray. But I'll let you two take
this. Want to go first? Want me to?
You go first, and I'll happy to take them in any order. I'll cover whatever you don't
okay.
cover.
You're correct.
You got to understand that Richard and I go back a long ways, and I tremendously admire this person, and therefore he's almost surely going to say whatever I would say anyway. It's safe to cede the first word to him.
We'll take it in reverse order, because my memory is not what it used to be. Look, I think what you had was the reluctant certification of the joint agreement by the administration, but still certification. The new sanctions that were added today were worked around the agreement, because the agreement was essentially a nuclear-only agreement. I believe it is not in the interest of the United States to unilaterally break the agreement so long as Iran is in essential compliance with it. We would isolate ourselves, not Iran. And given the theme of tonight, the inbox is sufficiently full without bringing this issue to the fore. So I think the United States ought to focus on managing what I would call the geopolitical challenge of Iran around the region. Iran is not a status quo power, and we need to take that seriously, but that's largely outside the nuclear agreement. We also better think about what comes after this agreement. Important elements of it expire. The agreement did not solve the Iranian nuclear challenge. It parked it for a number of years. So we had better think about what the multilateral, shall we say, response is, because we don't want an Iran that's unconstrained, and we don't want it to set in motion a proliferation cycle just when you thought the Middle East couldn't get worse. Trust me, it could get worse. On North Korea, just very quickly, look, there is that school of thought that North Koreans have watched a lot of recent history. Countries that have nuclear weapons tend not to get invaded. Countries that don't have nuclear weapons in some cases get invaded. Think places like Ukraine, Libya, when they give them up. So there is that argument that North Korea is acting rationally. But as Ash said, when you look at the progression of the North Korean leadership, you look at a lot of what they do at home and abroad, you're taking a big bet with the lives of an enormous number of people. And whether you're confident that deterrence would work, that rationality will necessarily prevail.
And but I would imagine what scares you is less the rhetoric and more the capabilities.
Well, it's both.
That have
not
evolved.
Just the rhetoric. Not the rhetoric so much as the patterns of behavior. And whether you're comfortable essentially resting the fate of a large number of your citizens on North Korean calculus. 30 more seconds, then I'll stop, then I'll turn to Ash for the final words. Where I disagree, Byron, with the, is where you set up the thing. China's not going to grow at 5% for the next several decades. And the real challenge in China, as the Chinese leadership know, is just that. How do you maintain the primacy of a party when the party largely derived its legitimacy for generations by delivering high levels of economic growth that cannot be sustained and will not return? That, to me, is the interesting challenge of China. Does China turn to greater nationalism to try to compensate? Does it suffer internal instability? Does it reform? I think those are the big questions of China. The one thing I'm not worried about is linear growth in China at 5% for the next three decades. A lot keeps me up at night, not that.
Final thoughts.
I just add on those last two subjects, just additive to what Richard said, and not to repeat what he said, which I agree with. On North Korea, it is a mistake, I think, to believe that their behavior will not change if they come to feel emboldened by having weapons that can intimidate their neighbors and fend off the United States. And this idea that they're just going to, all they want to do is be their own little Disneyland there, and they're not out to get anybody else. There's a lot of history, and I've dealt with the North Koreans. I've been to Pyongyang. I've been but that is today. Emboldened and with their neighbors threatened. What happens next time there's an exchange of artillery on the DMZ? What's the next time that, what happens next time there is one of these northern limit line fishing things or a Chonan type incident? You can't count on either to by itself wind down a circumstance like that. So I think it's dangerous to think that everything stays the same if they get nuclear, and they'll become kind of like a Brezhnev Soviet Union. I think that's very risky. And with respect to China, Richard's probably right about the rate of growth. Just a couple other things. When China in 10, 20, or maybe much longer years comes equal to the United States, that's not the time to abandon our friends, our principles, our policy, that's the Chinese narrative, that we're going to overtake everybody and that they'll have to do everything our way. I don't buy that. And militarily, it'll be a long time before they'll overtake. Remember, we've been spending a long time, and we're really good, and they're doing a lot, and they're trying, I see all that, but it's going to be a long time before the Chinese catch up with the United States. So I'm not ready to go with the numbers and check our influence and what we stand for in the Asia Pacific and all that we have at stake and all the friends that we have that believe what we have, because two lines on a graph are going to cross over. That's the Chinese way of selling something as fate, which I don't buy, and I don't think we ought to buy.
Well, after all this sobering news, high on the scary meter, the good news is there is a cocktail reception following this event.
And open bar, you need it.
I know that I sleep better at night knowing that you both are hard at work. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks so much.